And it's good that you say this because when I interviewed Bob Robinson from Tim and Bob, he said something that Jimmy and Jam and Terry Lewis did, and this is when they say they're working with Tamir. They said, look, what's going on? What do you want to? Let's be part of this. Give us some ideas of what you've been up to, and then we can write it, build something from this so that it's you feel some ownership in this, so we know what's going on with you. So, Jimmy used to say the same when they did the Control album, that they followed Janet around and she talked about her dad trying to take control. She talked about when it took it, some nasty boys were talking to her and she was like, these nasty boys talk to me and that I didn't, why didn't you help me? And they created a song based on so that's what Jimmy said. He said all these things, the whole album was based on just having a conversation with Janet and having her talk, and then they just created a song. So when you were saying about paying attention and letting the artists come in, that was what the greats are doing, Tim and Bob and Jimmy and Terry, making sure that they actually it becomes they're involved and it creates a more long-lasting song that isn't sort of force-fed on us.
That's it. But we do that too. At first, every session we have, the first sometimes 2 hours is just talking about what's going on. It's just getting to know each other. How are you gonna go in? We see some top lines will come in and they have like four sessions in a day, and we will just say, if you just had one, we would write a great song. But that's also the way it works right now. But Jimmy Jam, it's funny you bring up Jim about Jim Jam, because Jim Jam also told me. Another thing, I remember when we had some of our first hits, and I was sitting next to him at some Clive Davis party, whatever. And I would be like obsessed with like what chart position my song is on, whatever. And Jimmy looking at you and listen, all that energy you were spending right there, put that in the studio. Do the best you can in the studio. And once you're done and you've done all you can, you let it go. And whatever happens after that, it's out of your control. We're producers. You're not a marketing guy, and I really like that because it takes attention away in a session, sitting there finding out what songs are blah 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 and all. Focus on what you're doing, and our job is in the studio, and we love it.
The one thing you keep talking about is what's your relationship with Carlin? Because I listened to Jimmy talk about his relationship with Terry. There was no contract. They're more than brothers and more than friends. It's a partnership. And Elliot and
Never
Babyface
on
is
contract.
yes. So how is it with Carlin? Because you talk with him so
Just
glowingly.
brothers. But he's just incredible. He's just incredible. I will say that, we had a long, long, long run there. A lot of big records, 702s and Whitney Houston's and all this stuff. And I remember around 2000, Carlin was done. He was worn out from having to deliver hits. And it's what comes with the territory is we start getting paid a lot of money. And we will get a lot of money up front before the song is written. I loved it. Let me buy a Porsche. Great. But what you don't realize in that young phase of your life is you're putting a lot of pressure on yourself. Now you're getting a lot of money for a song that's not even written yet. And when they paid us that kind of money, like when R. Kelly was on an album or L.A. Baby or us or Timbaland or whatever, that was singles. That's where all the money went. So we couldn't write a good song. A good song wasn't good enough. No. They were expecting a number one record. And that catches up with you, especially Colin, who had the long hours in the studio sitting with every songwriter. So I remember in 2000, we had a session with Kelly Rowland. He goes, I don't feel like doing it. And I go, I don't either, necessary, but they paid us already. We have to do it. He goes, I don't want to do it. And I'm like, wow. So he took 5 years off. And I was all of a sudden by myself. I was sitting in the studio. I remember I came to my studio. We were down on Sunset Boulevard. And I was sitting at 10 in the morning and I said to Max, yeah, I'll see you. We would be home for dinner. Yeah. I didn't want to tell her yet, and I just sit in the studio and I never turn on the light. And at like 6 at night, I'm just still sitting in the same seat. What am I going to do? How am I going to do this? And in those 5 years, I managed to get by. I actually wrote the biggest record I've had in my career, which is Pitbull and Chris Brown, International Love. And I wrote that with, or produced that with a guy I always like to work work with people. I don't like to work by myself. I did that with a guy called Peter Beeger, but I missed Karlin so much. And when Maxie, when I lost her in 2015, he came back, and thank God.
Wow.
And we started working again, and we, you know, we're just brothers. When you've been through, when you accomplish something like that together, I don't think you're ever going to lose that bond. Unfortunately, I see a lot of people breaking up.
Yeah.
I really think that's something to do with your ego too. And I think with me and Colin, you know, listen, he knows I can be this and whatever. I'm the driving force of our team and whatever. But he knows little Carsten Schack, which is my name. Inside, you know, and he's still Kenneth Karlin. And it's Kenneth and Carsten. I'm from Aalborg, and he's from Rødovre. And that bond will, if you can keep that sincereness in a relationship, probably goes for marriage too, actually.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Then you don't lose. If you go on an ego ride and you buy a Porsche and say, it's okay, maybe you do it together. But you also have each other. Sometimes when you are night, cool, I love this house. I love this 100-inch flat screen I have. But why am I not happy? You know, and him and I just, since we've known each other so, it's the same thing I have with Maxie. You know, before when we met each other, she, If You Love Me, hadn't been released yet. And I hadn't had any hits yet. So that's also sincerity we had. We knew our love in, you know, and I guess you could say the Colin too, whatever, our respect for each other was sincere.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just, you know, when people go through this, I'm so sad when people break up and stuff like that. I understand you need breaks and stuff like that. And you also need separate lives. But yeah. I think in me and Colin's case, yeah. I mean, he's so talented. Yeah. I mean, the guy is crazy on those keyboards.
Yeah, but as I mentioned, I started off by talking about being a therapist. And part of why I do this was to really highlight that actually those within the industry, as famous and as rich as you guys are, can still struggle with mental health. So for Karlin, I can imagine why he would step back, because the pressure and you know, if depression could sink in, there's a lot of self-esteem or anxiety, and you need the break, and most people don't. They try and power through it. And that's important, especially as men. We think we, you know, we're macho and stuff. So I'm glad at least he was able to take that step back.
He's the guy who's teaching me that side. I'm more than macho alpha, whatever, but he's the one that constantly, he's more spiritual, and he will, you know, he will just know if he calls me. I'm like, and I'm just like what happened? Did you run out of coffee? Like, did the bagels not show up? Like, what's going on?
Yeah.
So, you know, we just have, he's such a gentle, beautiful soul. And I think he knows me so well that he can always, and just like I can help him, you know, but that spiritual side is definitely him that's, and that's, I think that's why we're still together. That's his, really, I give him that, his credit, because, you know, definitely when we were, had 10 number ones, whatever, I was, woo. I was flying. I did not see many things around me. I was just on top of the world. You know, thank God to have someone like Karlin as a partner. But, you know, because if I had some new American partner, whether also be both Danish, whatever,
people could keep
things a little grounded, even though grounded at that time would be still out of control for a lot of the people, you know.
Yeah. Hey guys, thanks for watching. Thanks for being a part of Halftime Chat. Please remember to subscribe, share, and comment. But most importantly, why don't you become a member of Halftime Chat? We've got amazing videos, amazing perks, and being able to support the channel. But anyway, thanks for watching. Take care.
I never participated in that kind of thing.